Tonight's presentation, Balky Alternator, and our presenter is Mike Bush. Mike is president of Savvy Aviation Incorporated and author for numerous aviation publications over the years, and holds certified flight instructor certificate, an A&P mechanic certificate, inspection authorization privilege, aviation maintenance technician of the year with the FAA in 2008, and of course a member of EAA. Mike, thank you so much for volunteering your time, bringing this information to us. We're so appreciative, and I'm going to turn control of the presentation over to you.
Well, good evening, everybody, and Happy New Year. I'm really looking forward to 2022. Hopefully things will be more normal than they were in the last couple of years. And Tim, I don't think you mentioned explicitly, but Home Builders Week is coming up later this month, and a lot of good presentations. I'm going to be doing presentations part of Home Builders Week, so looking forward to that. Anyway, tonight I want to tell you a tale. It has to do with an alternator on my airplane. This has happened quite a long time ago, but it's a story that I think there's some good lessons learned in, and it has to do with an intermittent problem that I had with one of the alternators on my airplane. And intermittent problems are always the worst kind of problems to deal with, because they always seem to happen at the worst possible time, like when you're in the middle of a long trip and you're a long way from home base, your trusted mechanic, your trusted toolbox, all of that stuff. And what's worse is they never seem to happen when you want them to happen, which is when you're trying to troubleshoot it or get your A&P to troubleshoot it. Generally, when you try to show a problem like this to your mechanic, it never happens, and that's really frustrating, because if the mechanic if the problem can't be reproduced by the mechanic, it makes it really hard for the mechanic to troubleshoot and fix the problem. So the case in point I wanted to talk to you about tonight occurred nearly 30 years ago. I was in the middle of a long 4,000 nautical mile cross-country trip that would take me from California to Colorado for an overnight, then Champaign, Illinois, then to Wichita, Kansas, down to Ada, Oklahoma, back through New Mexico with another fuel stop at Albuquerque, and finally back home to my home base at Santa Maria, California. I love taking these long trips. It's a wonderful use of the airplane. I'm always amazed how many general aviation pilots never stray very far from home in their airplanes. But one of my great joys in flying is taking these nice long trips, getting to see lots of the country and meet all sorts of people and so on. Now, this happened almost 30 years ago. I was not an A&P mechanic at the time. I was simply a maintenance-involved airplane owner. The A&P wouldn't come till a decade later. But at any rate, the first signs of trouble occurred as I was starting engines in Champaign, Illinois, headed for Wichita, Kansas, and started both engines. And with both engines running, I observed an amber warning light on the panel. It's an alternator failure light. There's two of these lights, one for the left alternator, one for the right alternator. And the right alternator failure light did not go out the way it should have when the engines were running. So that got my attention. At this point, of course, I didn't really know whether this was a real alternator failure or whether it was just a malfunction idiot light. There's a little sensor module mounted up at the alternator that drives that light, and those sensor modules have been known to go out. So the first order of business for me was to try to figure out whether I really had a bad alternator, whether the alternator wasn't working, or whether it was just the light that was malfunctioning. So to do that, I shut off the left alternator, the one that was good, to see what would happen when the airplane only had the right alternator energized. And in that configuration, with the known good alternator shut off and the questionable right alternator still energized, I observed the following. The right alternator load meter read 0 amps, so it indicated that the right alternator was putting out no current. The battery ammeter showed a discharge, which seemed to confirm again that the charging system wasn't working. The bus voltage dropped from 28 volts to 24 volts, so I was on battery power. And the red low volt light illuminated, which it would do anytime the bus voltage dropped below 25 and a half volts. So all of these things were confirming the same thing, and that was that the right alternator wasn't working. Okay, so I know I've got a non-functioning right alternator. I've got a working left alternator. Now I got to decide what I'm going to do. I'm sitting here with the engines running at Champaign, Illinois, about to launch for Wichita, Kansas. And I have to decide whether to go or no go. So the conservative decision would have been to shut down, try to find an A&P mechanic to troubleshoot this problem. That would all also been the FAA approved thing to do, because technically both alternators on a 310 are required equipment. So per 91.213D, you're not really allowed to placard the alternator in op and fly, since they're required equipment. On the other hand, if I did the conservative and FAA approved thing and decided not to cancel, if I decided to cancel a flight, that would mean scheduling a whole, canceling a whole series of scheduled commitments in Kansas and then Oklahoma. And another consideration was that Champaign, Illinois was not a particularly good place to get my problem fixed, but Wichita was probably the best place in the entire universe to get it fixed, because it's got one of the best twin Cessna shops in the country, Yingling Aviation, and it's got the Cessna parts depot right there on the field, so that any part that you might need would be available immediately without having to have to getting it shipped and so on. So to add to that go no go decision criteria, the weather was severe clear. And so FAA regs aside, I didn't consider that a flight to Wichita with one alternator inoperative would be particularly risky. If it was hard IFR, I think I would have had a different thought about it. But at any rate, so I'm sort of agonizing over this go no go decision. I've got all these arguments saying I shouldn't go, another argument saying I should go, and I'm trying to figure out what to do. And it was all this was going through my mind, something very unexpected happened. The amber alternator failure light went out. Well, I didn't expect that to happen, but so I went through the same procedure as I did before to try to confirm independently of the idiot light whether the alternator was working or not, checking the voltage, checking the ammeter, turning off the left alternator. And lo and behold, the right alternator was working. It spontaneously had risen from the dead, and it was now working just fine. This is what I have come to refer to as a transient anomaly, a problem that shows up and then goes away all by itself. I've had lots of these transient anomalies happen to me over the 55 years that I've been flying. And these transient anomalies can drive you absolutely crazy, because if I was to shut down the airplane and take it to an A&P mechanic, you know for sure he couldn't reproduce the problem. And if he can't duplicate the problem because it's flaky like this, he's not going to be able to troubleshoot it in any systematic fashion. And so what he's going to have to do is resort to the shotgun approach where you start replacing parts and hope to get lucky, because you can't really isolate what the fault is if you can't reproduce it. So over the years, I've learned that when you're dealing with problems like that are flaky and that happen sometimes but go away and aren't going to be reproducible easily by a mechanic, one of the best things to do is to just kind of be patient with it, sit tight, wait a while, see what happens. With a problem like that, if you are patient with it, generally one of two things will happen. Either the problem will get worse, or the problem will go away and won't return. If the problem gets worse, then it'll be a lot easier to reproduce and troubleshoot and so on. And if it goes away, it's probably not worth worrying about unless it comes back. Now, this approach of being patient with intermittent problems only applies to intermittent problems that are non-life threatening, like an alternator being flaky. If the intermittent problem is that oil pressure periodically goes down below the bottom of the green, then that's not a problem that you can safely be patient with. You really need to deal with it right away. But the majority of problems that we have with our airplanes are more annoying than they are dangerous. And certainly the failure of one of two alternators in a twin engine airplane is in that category. So in any case, the problem went away in Champaign. I made the flight to Wichita. The problem did not return. And I was able to make my scheduled appointments in Wichita and so on. But of course, it's always sort of a nagging thing. So sure enough, the problem eventually did come back. It didn't come back on this particular trip. The alternator worked fine for the whole rest of the trip. After returning to California, the airplane sat in a hangar for 3 weeks, and then 3 weeks later, I had to fly to Tucson to teach some courses at an aviation event in Tucson. And when I fired up the airplane to fly to Tucson, guess what? The right alternator didn't come online. Seemingly a replay of the situation that I'd faced a month earlier in Champaign, Illinois. So I thought, well, maybe this problem's going to cure itself. I let the engines idle for a minute, hoping that the problem would cure itself. Didn't. Waited another minute. Still wasn't good. So now I had to make a go, no-go decision. And once again, at Tucson, where I was going and going to be for several days, I knew there was an excellent shop on the field that could work on the problem, Premier Aviation. They were a major Cessna parts distributor, and it's a shop I would have trusted to work on the airplane. On the other hand, I'm at my home base at Santa Maria. There's not a chance that anybody on the airport at Santa Maria could come up with a replacement ALV 9510 100 amp alternator. That's not the kind of thing people keep in stock. So it would take me at least a day to get one overnighted, another day to get it installed, and so I would basically miss my teaching commitment in Tucson and disappoint a lot of people. And of course, besides, I didn't know at this point whether it was really the alternator's fault. It could have just as easily been a regulator or a bad alternator field switch or a field fuse or fuse holder or a loose wire or cold solder joint, all sorts of things it could have been. Just because the alternator wasn't working doesn't mean the alternator itself was bad. There's a whole bunch of stuff in the charging system that could have caused that alternator out. So Obviously, the some serious troubleshooting was in order. It's hard to troubleshoot problems when they don't sit still, but this time, maybe this problem was going to sit still for a while. I didn't know. Again, though, the weather, flying weather to Tucson was severe clear, making the flight on one alternator would have been perfectly safe, although not exactly legal. So I'm sitting here agonizing over it. And I'm taxiing out to the run-up area. I'm not sure what I'm going to do when I get there, but considering all of the pros and cons of what to do. And about halfway to the run-up area, the right alternator spontaneously came back online again. I double-checked it; it was working. Once again, my decision was made for me. I flew to Tucson. The alternator worked fine. But I promised myself that just as soon as I got home, I simply had to troubleshoot and fix this problem. I couldn't keep kicking the can down the road. One of the things that I had in mind was that I had a long trip planned the following month that would take me all the way to Key West, Florida, and then over Cuba to the Cayman Islands. And that's not the kind of trip I wanted to make, with an alternator out for sure. So at any rate, the alternator worked fine going to Tucson, but on the way back from Tucson, about halfway home to California, it failed in flight for the first time and it never came back. So I got home on one alternator, and I was actually happy about the fact that it failed in flight and seemed to be a hard failure, because that would make my troubleshooting vastly easier if the problem would sit still for me, and let me troubleshoot it. And of course, also it would make the troubleshooting compulsory. I just really didn't have any choice at this point but to deal with it. So I'm back home from this second trip, and now it's time to get serious about troubleshooting the problem. So the next morning, I went down to the hangar with my trusty Fluke 77 multimeter and some alligator clip leads and my parts and service manuals, determined to get to the bottom of this problem once and for all. I had no idea what part of the system was at fault, so I figured I'd start at the thing that was easiest to get to. In the Cessna 310, the regulators are mounted in an easy to get to location right under the co-pilot seat. So I figured that was a good place to start. I powered up the airplane, turned the battery and alternator switches on, got out my trusty meter, measured the voltage at the regulator field terminal, the terminal that feeds field voltage to the alternator. It measured 24 volts, just like it should. I then disconnected the field wire from the regulator and inserted the meter in series with it in order to measure the current, the field current that was going to the alternator. And it measured about 1¾ amps, which is just about what it should measure with the engines not turning. So this pretty much convinced me that the regulator itself was fine. It was doing its job, and the fault had to be downstream from the regulator, most likely in the alternator itself, but it could have been a problem with the field wire running from the regulator to the alternator, something like that. So with the meter still hooked up, measuring field current, I got out of the airplane and grabbed a propeller blade on the right engine and started rotating the crankshaft in order to rotate the alternator while I watched the meter. And as I was rotating the prop and therefore rotating the alternator, the field current that had been reading 1¾ amps started jumping all over the place, between 0 to 1¾ amps in a highly erratic fashion. If I stopped turning the prop, then the field current would settle down. But clearly there was some kind of internal problem in the alternator that was aggravated when the shaft got turned. And so as I was doing this and rotating the prop and watching the field current jump up and down, I heard a funny noise that seemed to be coming from the alternator. And when I looked closely, I observed electrical arcing visible through the cooling slots and at the alternator end cap, the non-drive end of the alternator. Every time I turned the prop and the field current jumped from 1 3/4 amps to zero, I could see and hear a spark inside of the alternator in the vicinity of the brushes and slip rings through those cooling slots. So that pretty much settled it. The fault was inside the alternator for sure. It was with the brushes and slip rings. The alternator was going to have to come off and get repaired. I was not in a position to open up the alternator and troubleshoot it any further myself. Well, I could probably open it up, but I didn't think I could get it back together once I did. So it was clear that the alternator was going to have to get off, come off, and get fixed. This was a good time to do it. I was between trips, had to get it fixed before I went off to the Cayman Islands for sure, but that wasn't going to be for several weeks. So, at any rate, now we're done with the troubleshooting part. We're now at the repair stage of getting it fixed. I wasn't an A&P again, but I thought maybe pulling the alternator off was something that I might like to tackle myself. So I got a hold of my colleague, Tom Carr, who's a long-term A&P IA, and said, "Hey, I got this problem with the alternator. I'd like to pull it off the airplane and send it out for repair and then put it back on. Would you be willing to supervise me and sign off the logbook entry?" And he said, "Sure." I said, "Would you like to watch me do it?" He said, "Not really, just holler if you need help." So I got a bunch of tools, and about 30 minutes later, I was holding the alternator in my hand. Taking the alternator off is not that hard. Putting it back on is a lot harder. But anyway, I got the alternator off. I hooked an ohmmeter across the field terminals, rotated the shaft. The resistance jumped all over the place. So it again, once again confirmed that there was a problem with the brushes and slip rings in the alternator. And the alternator didn't have a lot of time on it. It only had about 400 hours on it. And these alternators ought to, should really last between 1,000 and 2,000 hours before they need any work done. So it was a fairly young alternator. At this point, most A&Ps would just order a replacement alternator at a cost of about $2,200 overhaul exchange. But it seemed to me that doing that was overkill for a fairly young alternator with a known problem with brushes and slip rings. So I started making some phone calls to try to see if somebody would do an IRAN on the alternator. IRAN is one of the most important terms in the maintenance business. It's an acronym. It stands for inspect and repair as necessary. When you ask somebody to do an IRAN, you're saying, "I don't want you to overhaul it. I just want you to fix whatever is broken and don't do anything else." Some shops are willing to do an IRAN. Some shops are only willing to do a full overhaul. But at any rate, I found a shop in Southern California that said that they were fine with doing an IRAN on the alternator. So I overnighted it to them. They had it repaired within 24 hours and overnighted it back to me with an invoice for a grand total of $100. I was kind of curious what the shop found wrong with the alternator. So I phoned them to find out. And they told me what they found was that the brush holder was bent. It was misaligned so that the brushes weren't aligned properly with the slip rings, and they were sort of hanging off the edge of the slip rings, probably as a result of some sloppy work that had been done by whoever overhauled the alternator last. I don't recall who overhauled the alternator, but apparently the guys who didn't do a very good job, and they left the brush assembly misaligned with the slip rings. So what happened is that as the brushes wore, they developed a kind of a lip hanging off the edge of a slip ring. And when the lip got big enough and started touching the phenolic, it prevented the brushes from making solid contact with the slip rings, and that was causing my intermittent alternator issues with the field. So anyway, and so you can kind of see here's a bigger version of that diagram. You can see that after this got far enough, it would prevent the brushes from making a good solid contact with the slip rings and cause the field to go intermittent. So the solution was simply to bend the brush holder back to its proper position, install new brushes. While they were at it, they cleaned the slip rings, they inspected everything and decided everything else was in good shape, put it back together, bench tested it, sent it back to me with a bill for about an hour of labor. Pretty good deal. So I got the alternator back. I told Tom that I was ready to reinstall the alternator. Would you like to supervise me? He says, "Nah, holler if you need help. Call me when you're done. I'd like to inspect the installation before signing it off." So it took me about 2 hours and a bunch of cussing to get the alternator installed, reinstalled. There's four mounting nuts, and one of them is just like impossible to get to. So you need a bunch of special wrenches and stuff to get to it. But anyway, I eventually got it back on. Ran up the engine, verified that the repaired alternator was working okay, passed the smoke test. I typed up a logbook entry for Tom to sign. He came down, examined my work, and I signed off the logbook entry. And so this story ultimately had a happy ending. So in thinking back over this thing that happened 30 years ago, it seemed to me I did three things right. The first thing I did right was, instead of shotgunning this non-life-threatening issue while it was in a very transient stage, I waited until it got worse. And of course, now that we know what it was clear that it was going to get progressively worse. As the brushes wore, the problem would get worse and worse, and until it got to the point where I could reproduce it on the ground and troubleshoot it. Then, second of all, instead of replacing components and hoping to get lucky, I did a proper job of troubleshooting it and was able to isolate exactly where the problem was, that it was in the alternator, that it was a problem with the brushes, brush and slip ring assembly. And then, instead of spending $2,200 on an overhaul exchange alternator, I got the alternator I ran for about $100, because the, awful lot of stuff. The diodes were good, the bearings were good, everything was good. It just was this one thing that was wrong. So instead of overhauling this alternator, which would have been very expensive and involved replacing all sorts of parts that didn't need to be replaced, I got it Iran, and they just fixed what was broke with about an hour of labor and hardly any parts, and put it back together. Now, I don't expect every airplane owner to be as maintenance as involved as I was when this happened, but I do think there are some good lessons learned here. And perhaps the most important lesson learned is to, never ask a technician to fix an intermittent problem that he's unlikely to be able to reproduce. Because if you do, he'll have no choice but to shotgun the problem, replace lots of stuff that probably doesn't need replacing, and you won't be happy with the result or the big invoice. So when dealing with intermittent problems, patience can be a virtue. So that's basically the story I wanted to tell you guys, but I'd be happy to open it up for Q&A. I know there's, I've made a lot of decisions that might have been different than what other people would have made, but that's my story and I'm sticking to
Well,
it.
it's frustrating to get in these types of situations, isn't it?
It is. It
Yeah.
certainly is, especially when you're on a trip and away from home and have a lot of appointments and people waiting for you and stuff like that. It puts a lot of pressure on you, that's for sure.
We got some questions here, so let's start off with David's. David's just wondering what would be the possible cause for a rebuilt alternator periodically dropping voltage output and then returning to normal voltage in flight?
Well, I mean, very likely it would be a problem similar to what I had, which is something intermittent with the field. An alternator is basically kind of like a big mechanical amplifier. It takes field current in and puts voltage out, and the voltage it puts out is a function of the field current that is put into it. Then the regulator's job is to put the exactly proper amount of field current into the alternator to get the output voltage that is desired. In my case, in my airplane, it's about 28 volts, and the regulator tries to keep the bus at about 28 volts. And if it drops below it, it cranks up the field current, and if it gets above it reduces the field current in order to keep the output voltage constant. So generally, if an alternator starts putting out some voltage that isn't what we want, it usually has to do with something in the field circuit. Either the regulator isn't working right, or very commonly, something else in the circuit is causing problems. I know in single engine Cessnas we have lots and lots of problems with grounding of the regulator. If the regulator isn't properly grounded, then it will actually see a different voltage than what's really there, and it'll screw up its regulation. But something, intermittent in the field circuit, and again, it could be inside the alternator, like it was in my case, where the brushes are not making good contact with the slip rings, or it could be something external to the alternator, something in the field circuit. It could be the regulator. I've had problems where the field wire starts chafing against something and creates all sorts of problems. But basically, if you can cause the failure to happen on the ground, then you can generally just get out a meter and start working your way down until you find out where the anomaly is. If it's something that only happens in flight, it makes it a whole lot more difficult. So that's the curse of intermittents. You need to somehow get them to sit still long enough that you can get a meter out and start figuring out where they are.
Tom was wondering, where did you find the troubleshooting procedure for the alternator system? Was it clearly documented in the Cessna maintenance manual?
No, not at all. No, it's just I understood the system. I knew how it worked, and so I just started working my way through it. It was kind of, just kind of dumb luck that I actually got to see the arcing through the end cap of the alternator, which basically was the end of the troubleshooting process, because I could see the problem with my own eyes. But the fact that the field current was fine until I started turning the prop, and then it started jumping all over the place, made it pretty clear that it was not outside the alternator. It had to be inside the alternator, because it didn't happen until I started turning the alternator shaft.
Michael's wondering, should alternators be overhauled, replaced, or IRANed periodically?
Well, I mean, that's a good question. If the alternator is fairly long in the tooth, it probably makes sense to overhaul it. If there's a clear identifiable problem with it, like there was in my case, where I pretty much had it nailed down to exactly what was wrong, then having an IRAN done makes sense. You can always convert an IRAN into an overhaul. I mean, frequently, I'll send something out for evaluation. I did this a lot with like instruments and stuff, where before I decide what I want, the extent that I want done, I just want the shop that is going to open the thing up. If it's an if it's an instrument, it'd be an instrument shop. If it was an alternator, it would be an accessory shop, to open it up and find out what was wrong with it. And once they tell me what they find, then I can then I can give them, educated instructions as to how far I want them to go in the repair, whether I just want them to do an IRAN or whether the thing is bad enough that it's worth doing a full overhaul on it. So you don't really need to make that decision in advance. You can do that, after you send the thing into to a shop and ask them to evaluate it and then tell you what they found before you give them any instructions as to how to proceed from there. Same thing is true with an engine. We will frequently have an engine that has some internal problem that can't be fixed without splitting the case. We'll send it to an engine shop and ask them to do a teardown inspection and give us an inspection report. And then we'll decide whether we want to do a full overhaul on the engine, which is quite expensive, or whether we just want to do an IRAN.
Dean wonders, how about if it was a single engine aircraft? Would you follow the same process, or since there's only one alternator, would you just replace it and move on?
Well, I think the question really isn't whether it's a single engine airplane. The question is whether it's a single alternator airplane, because nowadays we have lots of single engine airplanes that have dual alternators, or primary and backup alternators or whatever, and so they would pretty much be the same case as the twin. But a single engine airplane that only has a single alternator and a single battery, you need to think very, very, very carefully before taking off in that situation. I think under those circumstances, I would be willing to make a short ferry flight to another airport where that was better equipped to repair it. But I don't think I would continue a big long cross country if my only source of electrical power was acting up, and my only backup was a battery that would keep things going for 30 minutes or something. You wouldn't want to go take a long cross country flight that way, because you might wind up getting stuck at a some place where you really don't want to be.
Gerald wonders, as a savvy customer, when there is an intermittent problem, how do we submit that? Is there ever a time we should submit it as AOG?
Yeah, if you, I mean, if you consider yourself AOG, you should for sure treat it that way. AOG being an abbreviation for aircraft on ground, meaning that that you're stuck somewhere you don't want to be. But yeah, the determination of AOG is in the mind of the pilot in command. If the airplane is in a state where he is not comfortable flying it, then it's AOG by definition.
Paul wonders, other than waiting until the alternator stood still, how much of that troubleshooting could a non-ANP do?
Well, obviously 100% of it, because I was a non-ANP when I did it. It really doesn't have anything to do with whether you're an ANP or not. The troubleshooting was something that anybody could do. In fact, my interpretation, this is an interesting question because it's not, the answer is not really written down anywhere, but my interpretation is that a non-ANP can take anything apart on an airplane. It's really the putting it back together that it needs to be done under supervision, because as a non-AMP, you can't approve the aircraft for return to service after any sort of a repair that goes beyond your preventive maintenance authority. And certainly, you know, taking off an alternator goes beyond your preventive maintenance authority. So you need to get an A&P involved. But, you know, technically, I didn't need to ask Tom for permission to take the alternator off my airplane. I really needed his supervision to put it back together so that he would sign it off.
Terry wonders, my voltage varies up and down by 0.1 to 0.2 volts all the time, regardless of RPM or taxi flight status, usually 12.6 to 12.8 measured on the EFIS. Is that normal for an internally regulated 60 amp alternator?
I would say that
variance is fast. It's usually, you know, plus or minus 0.1 volt per second.
Yeah, I would say that that's within normal tolerances. You're not going to be able to get voltage regulated probably more closer than that. And there are a lot of factors that could you know, that could affect that. But I wouldn't get too excited about voltage variation down in the couple hundred millivolt range.
Bobby's got a Cherokee Aero 2 and wonders, should the regulator be replaced at the same time as the alternator?
Not particularly, no. I mean, I don't believe in replacing things that don't need to be replaced. Unless the airplane is very, 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 very old, the regulator is going to be a solid state regulator. So it doesn't wear out the way an alternator does. Alternator is, you know, has moving parts and has stuff that wears out. Brushes wear out, bearings wear out. But solid state things don't have any specific life to them. They typically keep working unless they overheat or something.
Grover was wondering, have you had experience with an alternator drive causing intermittent charging problems?
Oh, for sure. Yeah, it happens all the time. This would typically be a gear-driven alternator. Yeah, gear-driven alternators have some sort of a drive hub that is designed to slip if the alternator seizes up so that it doesn't take out the engine. It's a, you know, a protective device, and we see all kinds of problems with those drive hubs. But nowadays, most of the hubs have an elastomeric coupling, a kind of a artificial rubber coupling, and they're kind of super glued together, and we see the couplings fail on a regular basis. We see them, you know, sometimes shed red elastomer into the engine. We wind up seeing particles of it in the oil filter and pieces of it sitting on the suction screen and so on. So yeah, those things fail pretty regularly.
Let's see. Andre just says, another good seminar, Mike! Exclamation point. What are the upper and lower voltage limits of a 12-volt charging system typically?
Well, I mean, normally the alternator should put out somewhere between 13.8 and maybe 14.2 or 3 volts, somewhere in that area. You know, when you say a 12 volt system, you're talking about a 12 volt battery, and the bus voltage needs to be significantly higher than 12 volts in order to charge the battery. If you connect a 12 volt battery to a 12 volt source, nothing's going to happen. There's not going to be any charging because the charging voltage has to be greater than the battery's voltage in order for it to take a charge. And the exact optimum voltage is sort of dependent on the battery's temperature, but generally speaking, 12 volt batteries need somewhere around 13.8 or more volts to charge properly. And if the regulator is the thing that determines what that voltage is, some regulators are adjustable, like the ones on my airplane. They have a little screwdriver adjustment where you can adjust what the output voltage is. Other regulators are not adjustable. But if the bus voltage is less than what it should be, then the battery will not take a full charge. The airplane will still work okay, but the battery will not reach 100% of its capacity. And that doesn't matter unless the alternator fails, and then you'll discover that you don't have 24 ampere hours worth of battery power to use to get you back down. You might only have 2/3 of that or something like that. So for emergencies and so on, and also in order to make sure that the battery is fully charged for the next start, especially if it's in cold weather and you need a fully charged battery to start the engine reliably, it's important that bus voltage be close to what it's supposed to be. It's a really good idea to have a voltmeter on the panel. If you have an engine monitor, most of those have a volt readout. If you've got a portable, Garmin GPS that's powered off the bus, usually those have the ability to read out bus voltage. But it's a good idea to have some kind of a voltmeter in the system where you can read bus voltage and make sure that the alternator is putting out the voltage it should be.
Ken wonders, does the alternator output have anything to do with the life of the battery?
It does in the sense that if the, I was saying earlier that if bus voltage is less than it should be, the battery won't take a full charge. But the opposite side of the coin is if the bus voltage is higher than it should be, then the battery will run too hot and its longevity will be seriously compromised. So that, it's another good reason that you should always have a voltmeter in the airplane where you can monitor bus voltage and make sure it's in the sweet spot.
Stephen was asking, are belt driven alternators more or less reliable than direct drive alternators?
Well, the alternators themselves don't care, but the drive system, as I was mentioning, the gear driven alternators have this drive hub, and the drive hubs have a history of developing problems. I mean, belts also develop problems, but they're right out in the open where you can see them, and it's generally. Well, I was going to say it's easy to change the belt. That's only true. if the belt-driven alternator is in the rear of the engine, it's usually very easy to change the belt. If the belt-driven alternator is like the typical Lycoming ones up front, then changing the belt requires pulling the prop off, so it makes it not so easy to change the belt. But at least the belt drive is something that's easy to inspect, and you can easily check the belt tension and so on, whereas the drive hub of a gear driven alternator is sort of buried in the engine and you can't really inspect it unless you take the alternator off Some shops prophylactically remove alternators in order to check the drive coupling every 500 hours or so. I'm not a big believer in doing that, and I don't do that on my own airplane because I just don't like taking stuff apart like that and putting it back together. But that's the disadvantage of a belt. I mean, of a gear-driven alternator is that you can't really inspect the coupling very easily. On the other hand, it's for really high amperage alternators, like the 100 amp alternators on my airplane, it's a little hard to belt drive those because it would take a pretty beefy belt to drive those things. So for big alternators like that, they usually are gear driven. I have big alternators on my airplane because the airplane is certified for flight into no one icing, and so it has an awful lot of heated things that require a lot of power.
Cynthia was asking, how serious is it if you lose an alternator fan? I had one disintegrate.
An alternator fan? That's a fan interior to the alternator, I guess. The problem with losing an alternator fan is that the rectifier assembly, the diodes, run pretty hot, and they need a lot of cooling air. And one of the most common reasons for premature alternator failure is that not enough cooling air is getting to the rectifier assembly to keep it cool. And the thing that causes solid state devices like those rectifying diodes to fail is that they get too hot. They're not properly cooled. So anytime we have somebody who has recurrent alternator failures that seem premature, you know, like alternators that fail after 300 or 500 hours, we usually suspect that they're not getting enough cooling, and we have to look into that. And again, it depends on how the alternator is set up, what the cooling situation is. Again, the big gear driven alternators in my airplane are sitting up there right at the very front of the engines with, 200 miles an hour air passing over them all the time. So they generally get pretty well cooled. The ones that are most problematic are the belt driven alternators in the rear of the engine. Or really any alternators in the rear of the engine. It can be gear driven ones too, where you have to do something special in order to get enough cooling air. Most of those alternator assemblies or installations have some sort of a blast tube that takes air from on top of the engine and directs it onto the alternator in order to make sure that there's enough cooling air there. And we've seen a lot of cases where, let's say, an engine gets overhauled or replaced or something, and the shop that installs the engine, either forgets to put the blast tube back on while they're installing the new engine, or doesn't position it correctly, and so the alternators aren't getting enough cooling air, and they start frying diodes prematurely.
Thomas was wondering, is it common for an alternator to drop offline at low RPM and then to be reset by toggling the alternator switch?
Well, the alternators have, I guess, what are generally referred to as a coming in speed, where below a certain RPM, they are not putting enough. They're not capable of putting out enough voltage to keep the battery charged. So it's pretty common for alternators to not function at low idle RPM. But if the alternator goes offline and needs to have the field switch toggled off and back on in order to get it to come back, that's normally a high voltage trip, an over voltage trip, which typically takes the alternator offline because of some sort of a high voltage spike, and those protective mechanisms, they can be a separate overvoltage relay, or they can be built into the regulator assembly. But generally, to get the alternator back after an overvoltage trip, you need to toggle the field circuit off and back on. It's a little surprising that you'd get an overvoltage situation at low RPM. Normally, it's something that happens at cruise RPM, but I suppose it's possible. Or it could be something wrong with the overvoltage protective device where it's triggering spuriously. For example, some overvoltage relays have a capacitor that goes across them in order to prevent them from seeing very, very short duration voltage spikes. And if that capacitor is left off or goes bad, then the overvoltage relay can start tripping spuriously when it really shouldn't, and take the alternator offline.
Jeffrey was wondering, do you prefer to have the plane's amp meter read current flow into or out of the battery, or alternator output?
Well, obviously what I would prefer is both, because they tell different things. And fortunately in my airplane, there's a meter with a four position rotary switch. And I can get that meter to read one of four things. It's either battery amps, current output from the left alternator, current output from the right alternator, and then the fourth position reads bus voltage. Doesn't read it terribly accurately, so I use my digital voltage readout really, but with that switch, I have the ability to read any of those four things on the little meter. But it's nice to have both. I know most single engine Cessnas are set up with a battery ammeter only, and a lot of the Piper Cherokees I know are set with alternator output only and not a battery ammeter, but ideally you'd have both.
Keith wonders, what are the pros and cons of alternators versus generators? My aircraft is a 1960 Bonanza.
Well, alternators are just pretty much better in every way than generators. And most of the generator equipped aircraft tend to get retrofitted with alternators. Yeah, there are conversion kits, STCs and stuff for doing that. But the alternator is lighter. It produces meaningful voltage, in other words, voltage capable of charging the battery at significantly lower RPMs. And it's less maintenance intensive. Tends to have fewer problems than generators.
Tom says, I have an older 310, which I changed from generators to alternators. I have a hard time keeping both alternators giving power to the system. So most of the time, one carries the load with the other in standby. Is that okay?
Well, it's not optimal, and the I would need to see a diagram of the system that you've got installed now, but basically it's a what's called a paralleling problem, but that that you'd really like the both of the alternators to be putting out about the same current. In my airplane and in many dual alternator installations, the regulators are paralleling regulators. There's a regulator for each alternator, but there's a line that runs between the two regulators so that they talk to one another and try to share the load. And it only works if the regulators are adjusted properly. There's a paralleling adjustment procedure in the manual. I don't know, some of the older twin Cessnas do not have paralleling regulators. They have a single regulator that provides field current simultaneously to both alternators, and you don't have any ability to adjust the paralleling. So those simply rely on the fact that both alternators hopefully are have very similar characteristics, and so with given similar RPMs and similar field currents that they'll put out approximately the same voltage, but there's no way of adjusting that the way there is in a paralleling system. So I'd have to see a schematic of your airplane in order to know what you've got. And whether
John
there's
makes a
anything you can, and whether it's anything you can do about it, in other words.
comment. He just says, "I've seen that on some alternators the pulley is pressed on. I had a piper that the alternator would occasionally drop off line. Ultimately, I found that the pulley was slipping on the shaft."
Well, again, it really depends on the configuration. My airplane has gear-driven alternators, and the drive hub, which has that elastomeric coupling in there, has a very, very super critical procedure for how you torque them on, how you secure the castellated nut with a cotter pin, and how you trim the cotter pin so that it doesn't have the potential of getting caught up in the gears. We've seen just tons of problems with that because it's very easy to make a mistake when installing the hub, torquing it, safetying it, and all of that stuff. It's very easy to do it wrong. We've had engines that needed to be torn down because the alternator wasn't properly prepared when it was installed, and it took out the engine to the point where it needed a tear down. That's something that tends not to be able to happen with a belt-driven alternator. It's hard for a belt-driven alternator to damage the engine, but that's one of the problems with gear-driven alternators is you got to do everything exactly right, or you put the engine in jeopardy.
John was wondering that you said if an alternator is long in the tooth, in respect to a question about overhaul, IRAN, or replace, what does long in the tooth mean?
Well, I generally would expect an alternator to last at least 1,000 hours, if not 1,500 hours. So, if an alternator is up over 1,000 hours, I would consider it to be, fully depreciated, let's say. And so, if it then starts giving trouble, it probably makes sense to overhaul it or exchange it. If on the other hand, if the alternator is relatively young, like the one in my story, it only had 400 hours on it when it started developing those problems. Then I think it's a better candidate for an IRAN because you're reasonably sure that it's not a case of the bearings being worn out or anything. It's probably something fairly simple to fix, like in my case, a problem with the brushes, or in other cases, it might just be a bad rectifier diode that needs to be replaced. But if it's a fairly young alternator, I wouldn't be real excited about doing a full overhaul. I would rather just fix what's broken and keep on trucking. But that's me.
Daniel is wondering, how often do you see deteriorated wiring connecting to the alternator, the section that flexes a lot as the engine runs?
Oh, I see it all the time. I've had problems like that on my airplane, for sure. Where that wiring, we said the alternator's out there in 200 mile an hour breeze, but all of that wiring is also in a 200 mile an hour breeze. And sometimes the 200 mile an hour breeze has rain in it, and sometimes it has hailstones in it. And so yeah, the wiring that's exposed like that is quite vulnerable and tends to give problems from time to time.
Jay was just wondering, he has a 60 amp alternator that runs no more than a 20 amp load. Is cooling air still important on that?
Well, it's important, but yeah, you're right that the cooling demand of the rectifier assembly has to do with how much power the alternator is putting out. And of course, like in my case, I've got 100 amp alternators because they have to be able to handle all kinds of hot windshield panels and heated stall warners and heated fuel vents and heated just about everything. But I don't turn that stuff on very often unless I'm flying in potential icing conditions. So most of the time, the alternators are loafing along for sure.
Isaac says, many times my alternator field circuit breaker pops on shutdown. It won't reset easily until after a few minutes, then can be pushed back in. Someone said, oh, you have a plain power alternator and you need a B and C. We replaced the alternator field wiring and all connections are solid. Any thoughts?
Well, I mean, it sort of makes sense that the symptoms you're giving, because the amount of alternator field current varies inversely with RPM. The faster the alternator is turning, the less field current the regulator is going to feed to the alternator in order to keep the bus voltage constant. So the converse is that as you retard RPM, is say low idle, and the alternator is turning slowly, that's when the regulator is going to be providing maximum field current. Now, theoretically, the alternator field breaker should be a high enough value that it never does pop except when something is wrong. But anytime a breaker pops, it's not going to be very happy about resetting for a few minutes, because the reason it popped is that an element inside the circuit breaker gets too hot. That's what causes it to pop. It's a bimetallic thing, and it needs to cool down before you can reset the breaker. So that's normal for if a breaker pops, it's not going to reset until it has a chance to cool down. But the question is, why is it popping in the first place? Because if the breaker is the proper value, it shouldn't ever get to the point where it pops under normal circumstances. So I think, maybe the first thing I would try to do is replace this the breaker, because maybe the breaker is popping at too low, below its rated current. If it continues to pop after you replace the breaker, then maybe you have some sort of a problem where it actually is pulling more field current than it should. But the maximum field current would be at minimum RPM. Actually, the maximum field current would be when the engine's not running at all. So that 1 3/4 amp that I was mentioning, which would be kind of normal for a 24-volt alternator that's not turning, 12-volt alternator, the field current would probably be about twice as much when the engine is not running. And so, but that low RPM or no RPM is when you're going to have the highest field current.
Michael says, the rubber on my Continental motor alternator coupling cleanly sheared right around the shaft of the inner gear. There is no shorts and alternator is spinning freely. Could that happen due to poor cooling of the alternator, or is it one of those things that just happens?
I would say it's more likely a quality assurance problem with the coupling itself. Like I said, those couplings are basically a elastomeric, you know, kind of artificial rubber that's kind of super glued into a pair of cups. And I've definitely seen ones that came apart, you know, not because there was a problem with the alternator, but because the coupling itself was defective. So that happens from time to time.
Okay, Fred was wondering, he's got an RV6, an alternator will charge after start and will indicate 6 to 8 amps. In flight, the alternator will decrease to 1 to 2 amps. If I turn off lights and just run flight instruments, amps will go down to 0 or -1 for just a second. Is this normal? Alternator is a 60 amp alternator.
Yeah, I mean it's perfectly normal because initially the alternator is charging the battery, and the battery is at least partially depleted because you used a bunch of battery power to get the engine started. And once the battery is fully charged, the alternator no longer is charging the battery, and so the only alternator output current is going to be what it takes to drive the actual loads in the airplane, which typically aren't very much unless you had a lot of stuff turned on. And I'm not sure exactly what current he's looking at, whether it's a battery ammeter or whether it's an alternator load meter. In other words, whether it's measuring a current that's going in or out of the battery, or it's measuring load. I assume it's a battery ammeter because alternator load meters typically aren't capable of reading negative. They start at zero and go up, whereas battery ammeters are, you know, can read both positive and negative as to whether the battery is being charged or whether the battery is providing power to something. And normally, if it's being charged, the meter reads positive, and if the battery is supplying current to something, it's reading negative. But anyway, it kind of sounds to me like assuming that he's reading a battery ammeter, what he's seeing is normal. That typically the alternator is charging the battery, but after the battery gets fully charged, it tapers off towards zero.
David says, my PA34 right alternator is cutting out after about 90 minutes of flight. Turning off the alternator and turning it right back on brings it back online for about 15 minutes. After that, it needs to be reset every 5 to 10 minutes. So far, turning it off and back on, no delay, just off and on, fixes it. Any ideas why this might be?
Well, I mean, it sounds like overvoltage trip, which, and then, so the next thing you have to determine is whether it there really are high voltage spikes that are causing those trips, or whether the protective device, whether it's a separate overvoltage relay or whether it's built into the regulator, I don't know. I wouldn't know that without looking at diagram. But whether the thing is tripping spuriously or whether it's tripping legitimately because there are overvoltage spikes, coming out of the out of the alternator. But if the alternator keeps going offline and you have to cycle the field switch to get it back, that invariably means that the overvoltage protective device, which is either a separate device or it's built into the regulator, is tripping. And so you have to figure out why, whether there are actual overvoltage spikes or whether the protective device is not working properly.
Laren was just wondering, would you have been able to get a ferry permit to move your plane in case the alternator was bad, to move to a place with better repair capabilities?
I would expect that I'd have no problem getting a ferry permit if the VISDO inspector that was processing my request could be reasonably convinced that where the airplane was sitting was not a good place for it to get repaired, and that moving it to a better place was a legitimate request. Yeah, because I mean, I think the FISDO inspector could be persuaded that the airplane was in safe condition to make the ferry flight. Normally what you'd have to do is get an A&P to sign a safe to ferry logbook entry. Because the FISDO inspectors don't like to come out and look at airplanes. So normally what they'll ask for is a logbook entry by an A&P, a safe to ferry logbook entry. And a safe to ferry logbook entry is a very low standard. You're not asking the A&P to say that the airplane's airworthy. If it was airworthy, we'd need the ferry permit. You're asking the mechanic to say that he considers the airplane in safe condition to make the proposed ferry flight, which is typically just relocating it to some other relatively nearby airport where you want to have the repairs made. And that's a very low standard, and usually there typically isn't a problem getting finding a mechanic who will sign off a safe to ferry entry, assuming that it's a reasonable request. And ferrying a twin with one inoperative alternator, that sounds like a very reasonable request for a ferry permit. So you shouldn't have any problem, really.
Brian says, in our SR22, normally the Alt2 light on the panel extinguishes during run-up when you push the RPM to 1700. However, ours began to stay lit at 1700 RPM, but extinguishes during takeoff and subsequent flight. Do we have an anomaly or a problem, he wonders.
Well, it sounds from the description like it's a deteriorating thing. I assume you've got one of the SR22s that has the a BNC standby alternator or something. And there's probably something in the book that says what the coming in speed of that alternator should be, and if it's been getting progressively worse and worse, that sounds like a problem that needs to be looked into.
Well, Mike, great webinar tonight. Great series of questions, everybody. Thank you so much for them. Mike, why don't you take a moment and share your closing thoughts with everybody? I saw, 970 people with us tonight, maybe even close to 1,000.
Good. Nice way to start off a new year. And
you bet. Yeah.
Happy to be doing this for the 13th year now, I guess it is.
It is. We're entering 13th year, and you've been with us the whole time. So
yeah, that's nice. Yeah,
you're an anchor.
It's a large body of work salted away in these videos.
No doubt.
Anyway, I'll just quickly run over the usual stuff. If those of you who are interested in getting on my mailing list, we send out interesting maintenance stories usually every week, and we send out a newsletter once a month that highlights, webinars and magazine articles, and we always have an engine monitor puzzler and bunches of stuff. It's all maintenance oriented stuff. So if you want to get on the list, if you're not already on the list, the easiest way is to pull out your cell phone and text the word savvy, SAVVY, to 33777. And that'll bring up a little text bot, which will ask you for your email address, your name and your email address, and that'll put you on the list. You can also get on the list by going to the savvyaviation.com website, where there's a button up at the top of this homepage that will allow you to get on the list. Or I think during the post-webinar survey that Tim's going to put up after I stop talking, there's a checkbox that you can check if you want to get on the mailing list. So any rate, all those ways of getting on the mailing list, I encourage you to do that. Everything we send out has an unsubscribe link. So if you have buyer's remorse after you sign up, you can get back off the list just as easily as you got back on it. My books are all available in the usual places on Amazon.com and the EAA bookstore. They just ordered a whole slew of them for in anticipation of Home Builders Week. It was nice. Also, Aircraft Spruce carries the books. All good places to spend your money. And my manifesto book is available in audiobook form. Hopefully, we'll get audiobook versions of the rest of them. Been working on them, but the other three books besides manifesto are big 500-page bruisers. It's a lot of work to put them in audio form, though. Manifesto is only a little over 100 pages. It's my little philosophy book. So maintenance philosophy. I do a podcast every month that is produced by AOPA with my colleagues Colleen Sterling and Paul New. It's a maintenance airplane maintenance call-in show, kind of patterned after the old Car Talk program, Click and Clack, the Tappet Brothers, that was on NPR. I encourage you to listen to the podcast. We have a lot of fun, and I think we do some, we help a lot of people with their problems, but we do it in a humorous way. It comes out on the first of each month, so the January podcast is up, but you can get it Spotify or Apple Podcasts or Overcast or wherever you get your podcasts. And if you want to participate, send your question, email your question to podcasts@aopa.org, and Ian Twombly will review it, and if he thinks it's a good question that we might want to put on the podcast, he'll get in touch with you, and we'll schedule you for our next recording session. We normally record them about the middle of the month, and then they get edited and so on and released on the first of the next month. And finally, upcoming EAA webinars that I'll be doing. February is one called Cylinder Rescue, very important subject, but talks about the various techniques that we have used with a lot of success for rescuing cylinders that come up with low compression without actually removing the cylinder, but rescuing the cylinder in place. So we'll be talking about that, give you a bunch of specific examples of ones that we've done. And the March one called Teardown Needed is talks about the when it's appropriate to tear down an engine and when it's a good idea not to do it. We really hate to see engines torn down unnecessarily, which happens a lot. Because an awful lot of shops and mechanics are what I call spring-loaded to the teardown position. But we like to try to avoid tearing down engines unless it's absolutely necessary. So that's really the whole subject of the March webinar. And then April is webinars titled Your Plane's Report Card. We'll be talking about some of the very useful reports that we can generate from looking at engine monitor data and looking back over engine monitor data history and so on. So we'll be giving some examples of what's in the report cards that we generate for clients that upload data to our Savvy Analysis platform, and how those reports can be useful and give you actionable intelligence for finding out if you've got problems either with your airplane or frequently with your operating technique. So that's going to be the April webinar. They're always on the first Wednesday of each month. And I think that's all I've got, Tim, until we do the February webinar.
Well, thank you very much, Mike. And the Home Builders Week webinar that you're going to be doing for us is on January 26th.
Ah, yes.
So, right. Yeah, that's just, 3-4 weeks from now. And that'll be Wednesday, January 26th, 7 p.m. And you're talking about selecting, preserving, and preparing your engine. So looking forward to that one.
Thank you for that. I should have thought to put that on the slide, but I didn't. So. Thank you for correcting my oversight.
No problem. Looking forward to, I'll be your host on that one. So looking forward to talking to you on that one for that Home Builders Week webinar.
You said
thank
that's
you, everybody.
January 26th.
January 26th is Wednesday.
Okay. Very good.
All right, everybody. Thanks for tuning in. Happy New Year. Hope you can join us next week. Have a wonderful evening, everyone.
Yeah, have a great 2022, everybody, and thanks for coming. Appreciate it.